Right, let's get started. Today we are looking at operating systems, and we said one of the functions of the operating system is file management. So today we're going to look at how the operating system achieves its file management. Right, we will not wait for others. They will join us, or they will check the video later, because we are behind time. Okay. So the operating system, look at the internal structure of the operating system and its design principles. And there's a guy called Kim Long who said something about the squirrel. I don't know if most of you know the squirrel. He said if there is one singular characteristic that makes the squirrel unique, among mammals, is that their natural instincts to hoard food. They've developed sophisticated capabilities in their hoarding. So they store different food types in different ways to maintain the quality. So for mushrooms, they dry them before storing, right? This is done by putting them on branches and allowing them to dry, then they take them. Then for pine cones, they are often harvested well, green and caked in damp conditions and keep them seeds from ripening. So the squirrel usually sweeps out husks from walnuts before storing. So you can see that it's an animal which has developed its own ways of storing its food. And so look at it also and realize that the operating system, in terms of fire management, there's also a unique way of storing the fires. So fires, we talk about files as data collections that are created by users. And the file system is one of the most important parts of the operating system to a user. So you realize that as a computer user, in most cases, or always, we deal with files. You do your work, you want to store your file so that it is not disturbed and so on. And these are the desirable properties of files that make them very important. So one, files are stored on the disk for long-term use. And you also have other long-term or secondary storage systems which enable you to store your files, and then the files will be available to the user at a later stage. Also files, they are desirable because they can be shared between processes and also between users. So in other words, you can share files, someone can edit a file, you take it back, and the other person can also work on it. That's another characteristic which makes files very important. So that's why we are saying the file system is one of the most important parts of the operating system that is used by the computer user. So also the structure of the file allows them to be organized in a hierarchy and more complex relationships among files can be reflected by the hierarchy that is used in storing files. So a file system also provides means to store data organized as files, as well as a collection of functions that can be performed on files. Remember, a file can also have a program which can be run. Right? So it also maintains a set of attributes associated with a file, right? That means each file has its own attributes or characteristics which allow it to be accessed in different ways. And so these attributes are maintained by the file system. In the operations that are done on files, one, you can create a file, you can also delete it. You can open or close a file, you can read from a file, and you can write to a file. Those are some of the operations that you can do to run a file, and that is because of the file system. So the file structure, you have a file, you have a record, sorry, you have a field, you have a record, file, and database, right? So these terms are normally used when you are talking about files, and we'll discuss them at a later stage to see the difference between a file, a field, and a record, and a file, and a database. So file can also be structured as a collection of records or as a sequence of bytes, right? So we have different operating systems which consider files as a sequence of bytes, the Unix, Linux, Windows, and so on. However, the IBM mainframe, it uses the collection of records approach, which means it is adopted to the use of databases, right? And so is COBOL. So those are the different definitions that we have for our system. So the smallest part when we're talking about the file is the field. The field is the basic element of data which contains a single value which can be fixed or of variable length. That's a field, single value. Then when you collect fields together so that you can treat them as a unit, they become a record, right? So one field is the key or a unique identifier. So we now have a record, you have one field, which is one number, which will be used to identify a record. And then when you put records together, that is, they should be similar or of the similar format, they produce a file, which can now also be treated as a single entity. And a file can be referenced by name, and you can put control restrictions at file level. So at field and record level, you cannot reference a record by name, you reference it by a key. And the field, you reference it by its value, right? Then when you put related data together or related files together, and also some records in some instances, you produce what we call a database. So in a database, you create relationships or links between files and records so that you can operate on it as a single entity, but it will be a collection of related data. So there should be a relationship between fields to produce a record. There should be a relationship between records to produce a file. There should be a relationship between files to produce a database. So those are the four common terms that are used in the file system. So what are the objectives of management system? One, it should meet the data management needs of the user. It should guarantee that the data is valid and optimized performance. It should also provide input-output support for a variety of storage devices, right? So you cannot have a file management system which only allows storage on your hard drive. It should also allow storage on other storage devices. And it should also maintain the integrity of the data so that it is not lost and is also not destroyed, and provide a SADA set of input-output interface routines to user processes. This is all done by the file system, and it also provides input-output support for multiple users in the case of multiple user systems. So those are the objectives of a file management system. It should be able to meet those, right? Well, I'm having a heads up that my internet connection is not stable. If anyone sees that they are no longer getting me correct, you can just put in chat so that I can see and wait for my internet to stabilize. So what are the minimum requirements for the user to be able to use the file management system effectively? One, the user must be able to do the basic operations on a file, that is creating, deleting, reading, writing, and modifying files. Two, the user may have controlled access to other users' files. Three, the user may control what types of access are allowed to the files. Four, The user must also be able to restructure the files in a form that is appropriate to solving a given problem. And the user should also be able to move data between files to backup and recover files in case of damage, and also to access their files by name rather than a numeric identifier. So you can see that the way you store your videos in your phones and the like, if you think it's interesting, you would give it a name so that you can easily identify it. That is a requirement for the user who uses the file system. So this is a file system software architecture. So at the top is the user program. This is what you interact with. You interact with the user program. Then there are different file organization. Some are file system, sequential, indexed, and hashed files. These are structure organization of files. So the user does not see this kind of information. This is handled by the file system. Then there's the logical input output, which makes reference to addresses. Then there's the basic input output supervisor, and then the basic file system. So from the logical input output, then the basic input output supervisor and the basic file system will now convert this logical input output to a physical input output where they can actually retrieve the file from the disk or from the tape. That is the software architecture of the file system. So it starts where the user can see, and everything else is hidden from the user and is handled by the file system, right? So the file system architecture, the top layer consists of a number of different file formats, right? These formats are consistent with the collection of records approach to files and determine how the file data is accessed. Even in bystream-oriented file system, it is possible to build files with record-based structures. Right? Then operating systems that include a variety of file formats provide access methods and other support automatically. So the user doesn't have to worry about how is this file being accessed. All you do is reference your file by name and the file system will take care of that. Then the file system will also give access methods to logical input output, basic input output, basic file system, and driver, device drivers. So that's the layer file system architecture, where the format, even the file format, will provide the access method to the users, right? So we talk about the logical input output and the basic input output. We are moving from reference to addresses, then we go on to the physical devices. Then you also have the device drivers, which are the lowest level. They communicate directly with the peripheral devices that are responsible for starting input output operations on a device. These device drivers now, in the old operating systems, you would need a disk where you install the drivers, then you'll be able to use it. But now with the new operating systems, most of the device drivers are already there. So once you plug your device, let's say a storage device, the operating system will now load the device drivers and enable you to access your file from that device. And it is very rare for you to have a device that is not realized. That's why you would need to use your installation system. Then the basic file system is also the physical input output level. Remember I talked about the logical level where I say it's just a reference to addresses in memory. Then the basic file system will now interface to the physical level. So this is the practical interface with the environment outside the computer system, and it deals with blocks of data that are exchanged with disks or other mass storage devices. So placement of blocks on the secondary storage devices and covering blocks in main memory are some of the functions that are done by the basic file system. And it is also considered to be part of the operating system. So the logical part, the one which deals with the user programs, then the basic or the physical part is the one which communicates with the computer hardware. Then we have the basic input-output supervisor, which is responsible for all file input-output initiations and determination. It controls structures that deal with device input-outputs, scheduling and file status. Then it also selects a device on which input-output is performed, and it is also concerned with scheduling disk and tape access to optimize performance. It was the input-output buffers are assigned and secondary memory is allocated at this level. So that's the supervisor which does all that, and it is also part of the operating system. Then we have the logical input output, which enables the user's applications to access records. So it provides the general purpose record input output capabilities and maintains basic data about a file. Like I said, this is the one which communicates with the user programs or the applications, and then it gives back to the input-output supervisor for those which are related to them, to the hardware access. Then the logical input-output is the level that interface between the logical commands issued by a program and the physical details required by the disk. That's why we need a device driver in between. So the command they give the logical, which are referenced to the memory and the CPU. Then after that, we go on to the section which deals with the physical part. That's where the device driver comes in, so that all the logical addresses and everything that is done in the program and the software is translated to physical blocks. So logical units of data, these are physical blocks of data to match disk requirements. That means when you are doing the memory that you are referencing in your program, that memory will also should match with the requirements of the disk, so that you can access it, okay? You can talk about it as, let's say you have your letter. Your letter is addressed to PO Box 17, whatever. And then the person, it may be house number 15, owns the PO Box something, something. So if someone sends a letter to PO Box, whatever, then the person on the physical address will access the letter through the letter box. So that is the actual translation that happens there. So if no one is there to access the letter from the box in the post office, then the letter will not reach the actual address where it's supposed to be going. So those are the translation that we are trying to talk about. Then we look at the access methods. We look at the access methods. Right, we can take a break and come back and look at the access methods. For the time being, we wait here so that we go to the access methods of the file system. Okay.